We're going to answer a question. Did Jesus do it all? You know, we hear, well, he completed everything at the cross. Everything was completed. But is that the truth? There's been a doctrinal nightmare, a theological dispute, you know, a whole series of theological disputes, and faith-destroying comments by a number of Christians and believers that Jesus did it all so we don't have to do anything. Well, Yeshua opened every door that he was able to for us. And he did it for you to be justified, saved, and made righteous. However, he did not do the things he told you to do. Otherwise, if he was going to do those, he wouldn't have told you to do them. Jesus made you responsible for a great many things. He will not override your free will on any of them, but he did tell you to do them. When you ask, he will strengthen and assist you, but he does not do it for you. And especially all the things for you. He has certain things. Character must be built. Integrity must be built. In our society today, they say, well, whatever feels good. But that's not character. That's character assassination. And this is where all sorts of confusion, chaos, and schisms take place. It's because they're not looking at what Yeshua really said. They're looking at some twisted format of misinterpretation of what he said. And you have to go back to his basic principles. As we look at Matthew 5, verse 3, what's called the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Well, the humble person is blessed because they are teachable. But if you say that you don't have to be teachable, you're not blessed. You know it all. You're not blessed. They have set their heart on knowing and obeying Yeshua and his written word. The poor in spirit resist. They have a resistance to pride. They're not pompous jays. And they seek Jesus or Yeshua to help them in doing everything. In many places it says, give thanks and rejoice. And that in the First Testament, for Jesus has given us the strength and the guidance to do all things. He's caused us to accumulate what we have because he's blessing us. So, if you stay teachable, you acknowledge that he's the one in charge. The second point is, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Do you know that I read one commentary on this, and that they believe that means that if you pray in a whiny, snivelly, crying voice, that you will be heard and comforted by God, and He'll do whatever you told Him in your whiny prayer. But that's not what that is saying at all. And others believe that, as most of the Christian world believes, that this means to be make woeful sounds and complaining noises or crying on cue when you're told it's time to cry. Or sniveling all the time. Quite a bit lover to wine. Not referring to the drink. But there's a poutingness that is enforced. And some believe that even having a tizzy fit is what God wanted you to do here, to show that you were mourning. Because you're not having your way, you throw a tizzy fit. Well, I don't see any scripture backing that. Can anybody show me one? No? But these great theological scholars seem to believe that this is an okay practice. And that's not what the word to mourn means. Mourn means to see where governments and churches and societies are making wrong choices, and then bring this before our Father for resolution and healing of the pain that they're causing in society. To acknowledge the sin of our governments. If you, even the sin in the churches of the world, they're worshiping false gods. They've taken on a false Sabbath. They've taken on false feast days. Well, that's got to be, that's what the mourning refers to. You acknowledge this to your Father and thank Him for the kingdom, for restoring all things to righteousness. Mourning is a choice and an attitude of finding reasons for God to bring forth His kingdom and end all the error and injustices and pain that following Satan has caused in our world. It has nothing to do with what kind of sounds you make that are not of God. It's how intense is your prayer? How committed are you that that's wrong and God's right? Point number three, blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. This causes a lot of, shall we say, distress among theologians who believe that the kingdom of heaven is in at God's throne, and those that are just gentle believers, they have to stay on earth and watch them have fun in heaven. And that's what a loving God wants. The punishment for them being gentle, loving one to another. And many translate gentle here to mean a humble or meek, but that produces a very weak understanding of the meaning. It means those who are not vengeful, those that are not spiteful, those that are not gossipers, are not mean-spirited, loud-mouthed cursers. They're not intimidating to others. They're not demeaning. And they're not demanding their own way with consequences if they don't get it. There's no vengeance or revenge or vendetta in them. That's what a gentle person is. They bless and they pray for their enemies, and they do not cause them harm. They are not demeanors, and they're not demanders of their own way or rights, but they do maintain godly boundaries. Now, what's a godly boundary? Do you know it's not listed in any of the commentaries? What a godly boundary is? Well, when you do away with the commandments, mm-hmm. and the statutes and the judgments,
there's no more boundaries left.
There's no boundaries. So, what is a godly boundary?
According to them, there is none.
That's why they can do what they want.
The godly boundary is when you can satisfy your emotional pleasures for the day.
I can even get all wrong.
That's the only thing they leave open for a godly boundary.
And fun.
No, they don't care about fun. Fun's a God-given blessing. They want lustful excitement. There's a difference. Have you noticed that what you lust after isn't fun?
And there's always a price for it.
And there is a price for it.
Well, there's no satisfaction because lust
is never satisfied.
Never satisfied.
Mm. Well, you see, there's a hunger and thirst, and he says, you're satisfied. But are we living in a world that's satisfied with anything?
No.
Absolutely not.
How many were satisfied with the meal last night? At least four people, right?
I was still satisfied this morning.
Yeah.
Okay. It's the word satisfaction implies the thankfulness, the gratitude, the rejoicing, and the willingness to share. The fifth point is, blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive anger and rage.
Wrong.
Wait a minute.
No, it says mercy. If you sow mercy, you receive mercy. If you sow good things, you receive good things. So what happens when you sow bad things?
You
receive bad things. Why would you need mercy if Jesus has accomplished everything for you? Why would you need mercy?
You wouldn't.
You don't. Mercy is an active choice for attitude, action, and forgiving. It's active. It's never passive. Therefore, when you show mercy, you sow a seed for atonement. It becomes a show of faith by works. So if you can't show mercy, you can't have faith by works. Your works will not be of faith, it will be of what? Your own strength? Demands of others? That's not faith. This is not making up an excuse for another's shortfall. That's not what mercy is. You know, it's not even when you make them an excuse for why they are committing errors or sins. That's not what mercy is. Mercy is covering the cost of it without complaining. Yet teaching the person that has offended you or has sinned against you or someone else, there's a teaching of love by how you deal with it. And it establishes what is expected of them by mercy. See, mercy is a neutralizer for murder, anger, rage, hatred, and such. It neutralizes these demons. It disarms the demons. How effective is a demon without arms? No, it reduces his power dramatically. The sixth point is, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. People generally claim this is only about lust. Pure heart, you don't have any lust or sexual perversions. But to be pure in heart means something else. It means having a steadfast heart for Yeshua, for Jesus. A steadfast heart, not wavering. And it means you're looking for answers in His Word, and you're looking forward to His kingdom coming. It means you're not diluting with the world. You're not taking 50% of what you believe out of the world because that's what others did to worship their gods. It means you stay pure. It means to be totally clear of the religious traditions, religious celebrations, and the religious doctrines and dogmas of the world's religions. And it means to be filled with all the things of the eternal God, the things of love and the things that are revealed to us. And now please take note of the next statement. For they shall see God. When?
When He's ready for us to see.
Right then. Right? While you're...
If your pure in heart, you allow Yeshua to manifest in your presence. To instruct you, to direct you. It's not a guessing game. It's a matter of getting rid of the religious traditions, the religious celebrations, the religious doctrines and dogmas of a world that is pagan but claims to be Christian and claims to be believers, and they don't know Yeshua. This is not a promise for the next life that you'll see God. It's not a promise for the next life. It's for this one, right now. It is the promise for the here and now. Jesus said that he can manifest in the presence of someone who has a pure heart. How many did he talk to in the First Testament?
One every generation, was it?
No. We know he talked to Abraham several times, and other times he sent his angel to represent him. Talked to David. Mm-hmm. Talked to Solomon.
Like Moses face to face.
And Moses face to face, yeah.
Been a few. And Adam and Eve before they fell.
Yeah. Is there any chance they were pure in heart when they were talking to him?
I would say yes.
How about when he talked to Jeremiah? He says, oh, I'm a man of unclean lips and a nation of unclean. None of them speak the truth. They're all liars. Me included, he says.
He was humble.
Isaiah said that too. Yeah.
He was Isaiah.
Yeah. But it's just that their presentation was
pure in heart.
They wanted to be pure in heart.
The desire was there.
Yes. The desire was there. Pure of heart require an active, sustained, and maintained relationship. Not for whatever whim flows moment to moment. Jesus can help you into it, but you have to desire it. You have to want it and appreciate the door open for you to walk through in order to have it. You know, you can't go halfway on a pure heart. It's either you want to go all the way or you don't go anyway. There's no way you can get into it. The weakness of the flesh hinders the development of the pure heart. But that cannot stand, because in the end the pure heart stands steadfast and will always see Yeshua, will always seek him, always be knocking for him, and will always have him. Okay, point number 7. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called Gerbites.
You're wrong.
No?
No.
No. Sons of God.
Yes.
This is one of the main 10 reasons that Christians cling to the grace revolution and its greasy grace lawlessness. They believe that they can do nothing to influence peace in the world. Therefore, Jesus must have done it all. But what does the Bible mean by being a peacemaker?
Don't go out looking for trouble.
Well, who will help settle a dispute? Who will forgive?
Or pray for?
You don't go trying to cause an argument.
And those that do want to argue with you, you can...
Soft answer turns away wrath.
Yeah. But a peacemaker is one that walks in the light, but doesn't try cramming it down anybody else's throat.
Just set the example and let it be.
Mm-hmm. They will come and ask you why you have the joy. Okay. They try and, when there's two in argument, they try and work out a negotiable settlement that's good for all. They don't try and stir up problems. So, the first thing we see in a peacemaker is one, relationships. You see, they're willing to build relationships like a husband-wife relationship. Parents to their children, they have a relationship. Children to uncles and aunts and grandparents, there's a relationship. Neighbor to neighbor, there's a relationship. They develop healthy relationships. Okay? The second point in it is the contractuals. They don't create disturbances in the contract. And you can have a contract, an individual to an employer. You don't try and cause the employer to lose money. Okay? That's not being a peacemaker. You don't sabotage his equipment. Steal his supplies. You can have a contractual as individual to the police. You know, we're supposed to be supportive of law and order and justice. But a lot of times it's law, disorder, and injustice that's being perverted. How do we become a peacemaker in that? We pray for the justice be done in the situation. And we have governments and agencies that we have a contractual agreement to. You know, try avoiding filing your income tax. What do you get?
A big bill, probably, if you later on.
They track you down.
Yeah.
You know, we're supposed to be a peacemaker with nature. Balance as to husbandry and protection. You know, and it's strange because we read in the Word of God as the hills rejoice, the mountains rejoice, trees clap their hands and sing. See, everything that was made to worship. And if we disturb that, if we try and destroy it, we're not a peacemaker. peacemaker can be at peace with themselves. We see it with body and soul. Soul and spirit. We can see it within your brain and the goals. God is giving you some purpose, but it should become your goal. If you're fighting it, you're not at peace. Yeah, and your brain and purpose, or we also have where you have visions, dreams and visions, and you know when you fight those, when you say, well, that can't mean anything to me, or that's not from God, or that, and you don't pray about it to find out, you're not a peacemaker. You're trying to make war with God for giving you a vision or a dream. Do you know you have to be at peace with yourself for health? Whether it's for your eyes, ears, heart, you know, stomach, whatever. You have to be at peace with yourself. You can't be putting something else ahead of Yeshua. Otherwise you can't be at peace with yourself. Okay? And you have to learn how to keep your tongue in peace. You know how easy it is to make a sharp, biting comment that really assassinates another person's character or will. It's very easy. But a peacemaker doesn't do that. They'll endure a pain rather than cause another pain. We're called to be peacemakers with God. Again, this goes between you and your dreams. You and your praise. If you're not praising, then what are you doing? You're trying to make war with God. Who do you think is going to win?
Three guesses?
Can we bet? You sure bet.
You and your worship. Okay. You and your prayer time. You could be at war with God in your prayers. Just start whining at Him. Cursing Him. Not a good idea. Again, it goes into you and the plans God has for you. He says, I have good plans for you. If you fight them, what plan are you after? The bad one? No. God has commissions that He's giving you. If you're fighting, carrying them out, what are you doing? You're not being a peacemaker. You and the new moons. If you're not bringing things to your Father through Jesus to be turned over to the cross. Jesus, you know, to be turned over to Him to crucify. You're at war with your Father. You're not a peacemaker. We could even say you and your calling that God has put on you. If you're rejecting your calling, you're not a peacemaker. That doesn't look good for you. If you're not making peace with the things, with these things, then we are warmongers, not peacemakers. You are chasing and choosing to blind yourself. You're choosing blindness versus being a peacemaker. And when you are blinding yourself to all the directions and protections from God and all that He's offering, I would say you swallowed a whole pile of stupidity pills. But that's what people do. That's what terrorists do. They refuse to be peacemakers. The eighth point. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The world thinks this means go and convert the world to the Lord. But this is not what Jesus was speaking of. You know, you're supposed to be the salt of the earth and the light to the world. But He says His Father does the calling and He does the choosing. So what are you doing if you're interfering? You're getting persecuted for your own stupidity, not for the will of God, doing the will of God. When you are persecuted for obeying Yeshua or Jesus, obeying the 619 laws, judgments, and ordinances in the First and Second Testament, as you seek to do our Father's will on earth as it is in heaven. See, if you're not trying to do your Father's will on earth as it is in heaven, He hasn't done away with any of these 619 laws and stuff in the First and Second Testament. So you can't. If He didn't do it, you can't. Doing the right things in our Father's sight is righteousness. So He gave us the guidelines of what to do and what not to do. And please note, Jesus did not say He would do it all for you so that you could live in unrighteousness, that you could choose to live unrighteously. No, you have to choose to obey. And when persecution comes, you must seek the help to endure it, to walk through it in forgiveness and love. And then you're rewarded. You're not rewarded of having your own temper tantrum because you didn't get your way. Number 9 is from Matthew 5, verse 11. Blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely on account of you obeying me. That doesn't sound like you go do your own thing and get blessed. That's quite contrary to the Grace Revolution, that statement. Many believe that every time that they are persecuted, reviled, or labeled, or slandered, that God has to bless them, regardless of what they're doing. But they miss the ending, where one needs to be following Yeshua Jesus, obeying Jesus, and relying on Jesus for this blessing to appear. It's a doing process, and it's cause and effect at work. You must choose to do by following, speaking, and acting on the word the way you've been guided and taught. Now, the 10th point is found in Matthew 5, 17, 18. In verse 17 says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to complete or to bring to fullness." Verse 18, "For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away." Have you, anybody noticed that, whether it passed away or not?
I don't think it has yet.
No, I don't think so either. "Not even the smallest letter or stroke shall pass away from the law. Not until every prophecy is accomplished as prophesied." Well, they're not all complete. And you're saying the law is done away with in favor of easy grace and the grace revolution? You're 1,000% in error. And here lies the aspect of doing, not striving. All who claim that Jesus has done it all fail to understand what "do not think that I have come to abolish the law" means. They fail to read the next verse, which informs you that until heaven and earth pass away, and they haven't yet, you can check on it, then not even the smallest letter or stroke shall pass away from the law. That means the law is still in force and still has to be obeyed. It's the law of love. It's a spiritual law now. It's not "thou shalt not," which refers to your flesh. It says love doesn't do this, but love does this other thing. Therefore, the law stands, and grace does not wash it away. Nowhere does it say that grace washes away the law. It is the covenant for entry into the kingdom of God through Jesus, through Yeshua. With Yeshua's death and resurrection, the law is now more in the spiritual for believers than ever before. And the law of death is for non-believers. The Ten Commandments still stands over non-believers as "thou shalt not." But for believers, it's "love doesn't," or "love does this, not that." And it applies to not only the law, but the ordinances and the judgments. I mean, how great of a world would it be if every 15, 20 minutes somebody was trying to rape you or trying to kill you or steal from you?
No fun.
Well, would you say that if you say the law's done away with through grace, you're saying all those things are okay to do to you? That you want to sow them into somebody else's life and you want to receive 100-fold back in yours? Well, that doesn't sound like peace and love and joy to me. Love is the spiritual component of all God's laws. statutes and ordinances. We got to keep that in mind. We need to love them in order to be empowered to obey them and to love Yeshua at the same time. He's the one that gave them to us. And that is the grace of success, of victory, the grace of victory, of real repentance. When you recognize that you're under a spiritual law, and the spiritual law, it tells you what love does and doesn't, does do and does not do. Jesus broke the curse of the law, and maybe many think that means he destroyed the Ten Commandments and all the judgments and statutes. But they fail to connect that with the wages of sin, which is the breaking of the law, or the, shall we say, the breaking of the law is death. So the wages of sin is death. And by his own death, Jesus paid that penalty so we could learn to walk in love and keep the laws in the Spirit written on our heart. However, we have our part to do. If we ever want to be part of the kingdom of God, we have to look at what's our part. What part do we have to accomplish? And it's not looking at this mythology of saying, well, Jesus did it all, we don't have to do anything but go and enjoy whatever emotional pleasure comes our way. There is a lie that we should avoid at all costs. Jesus did not do it all. He did all that he was required by his Father and shown to do by his Father. But we have our part. If we want to be in the kingdom of God, if we want to inherit, if we want to walk in righteousness, we have our part to do and to choose. And a lot of it's just involving being steadfast in what we know is true. It's an easy yoke. So we bless you with a piece of this, and that you realize that this is the beginning of why they came out of Egypt. So they could have the real law of love, the spiritual law, and the grace to do it. And what we celebrate now. So we bless you all. In Jesus' name, amen.